The research that both you and I are about to delve into is exquisite in a couple of different arenas. Number one, we are going to be discussing glycerin in regard to an animal model in where they tested glycerin with induced psoriasis. They did this with the intent because they heard many stories of individuals receiving great benefit, especially in regard to psoriasis and other skin inflammatory disorders. And they wanted to take this journey in order to delve into exactly, is this just psychosomatic, or is glycerin actually having a basically clinical effect in mitigating the harms of those particular skin conditions or other skin conditions in reference to inflammation? But in the case here, they looked at the mode of action in regard to psoriasis. Now, what makes this study beautiful is two different things. One, it is a very common substance. Actually, I should say three different things. Two, whether it be ingested or applied topically, in this case, in a 50% dilution when they used the animal model of 50% glycerin and 50% water, or an ingestion, it was a 2% solution. And three, the methodology of application. Obviously, the drinking or topical. Now, what they did discover quite intriguingly in reference to the research itself and hypothesis on how it's yielding such benefit is that glycerin converts over to phosphatidylglycerol, then ultimately helps in the regulation of keratinocytes and therefore help keep inflammation in check. And it also has a different mode of action in reference to how it described as far as ingestion. And hydrogen peroxide is going to play a huge role here in reference to the study that you and I are about to reveal. So with that in mind, and without further ado, let's get right into the research as follows. Glycerin is safe, effective in psoriasis model. They found that whether applied topically or ingested in drinking water, glycerin or glycerol helps calm the classic scaly red rays and itchy patches in the psoriasis model. Keep in mind, this was an animal study. Topically, glycerin is known to have a soothing emollient effect, but another key part of its magic, the researcher claims, I think Dr. Bollag, please forgive me if I mispronounce, has helped delineate. It is conversion to the lipid or fat phosphatidylglycerol, which ultimately regulates the function of keratinocytes, our major skin cell type, and suppress inflammation in the skin. Glycerin gets into the skin through avenues like aquaporin 3, a channel expressed in skin cells, and the MCG scientists have shown that once inside aquaporin 3 funnels, glycerin to the phospholipase-D-2, an enzyme that converts fats in the external cell membrane into cell signals, ultimately converting glycerin to, as we discussed before, phosphatidylglycerol. Externally, glycerin showed its action as an emollient because even in mice missing D-phospholipase-D-2, it was beneficial. And additionally, topically, it appears to compete, here it goes, hydrogen peroxide, for space inside the aquaporin 3 channel. Hydrogen peroxide is commonly known as a mild antiseptic, but we produce it as well at low levels. It's a cell signaling molecule. But at high levels, hydrogen peroxide produces destructive oxidative stress, which can actually cause psoriasis. And as we covered in the past before, reference to hydrogen peroxide, the enzyme catalase, which helps break hydrogen peroxide down in the hair to help possibly mitigate the progression of gray hair or loss of color. But to proceed, I digress. The scientists found that topical glycerin reduced the levels of hydrogen peroxide entering skin cells. When they added glycerin and hydrogen peroxide at the same time directly to skin cells, they found that glycerin protected against the oxidative stress from hydrogen peroxide. Quote, glycerol is basically outcompeting the hydrogen peroxide and getting in there and preventing it from being able to enter and increase oxidative stress, quoting Bollag. Oil and water don't mix. So yet another way glycerin may be beneficial is by supporting, another hypothesis, supporting the skin's major role as a water permeability barrier. So that as an extreme, when we sit in a bathtub, the water doesn't pass through our skin, so we blow up like a balloon. All right, case in point, you get an idea. Now, ingestion. On the other hand, when glycerin was ingested by mice missing the phospholipase D-2, which converts fats or lipids in a cell's membrane to signals, once again, it simply didn't work, which confirmed earlier findings that internally, anyways, glycerin pairs with the enzyme to produce signals essential to skin maturation. So again, the glycerin seemed to have a positive effect in reference to a 2% solution just in water. Nothing fancy, just a little bit of glycerin and a lot of water. Now topically, half and half. You can't get much easier than that. But still, that's how it appears to work, hypothetically at least. But yet, the outcome in many an individual, which used to mix rose water and glycerin, glycerin soap, and so on and so forth, is being validated not just through observation, but actually hard data as well. Now, let's go right to the animal model per se as far as the dosaging, just so you could see exactly what they used in reference to the topical application. Nothing complex, elegant in its approach. Now, whether emulsifiers or DMSO added to it whatsoever, just glycerin, water. And as far as the ingestion model, there you are, as far as a 2% solution or 2% glycerin, and obviously 98% water. So what the researchers learned or speculated in reference to how it may work is as follows. Yes, it's helping regulate the inflammation in reference to the keratinocytes, but it's doing this by the glycerin being converted over to, with the phospholipase-D-2 over to phosphatidyl glycerol per se, and then doing its magic, as well as potentially working with the aquaporin 3, competing against hydrogen peroxide, getting detailed enough, you know what I mean? But regardless of that, and by competing with hydrogen peroxide, reducing down its, when it's over too much, its overly oxidative effect in reference to the skin itself, and therefore causing other problems. But it yields the benefit primarily in the conversion to phosphatidyl glycerol. So we have to be grateful that the researchers did the research they did. Animal model is validating a lot of what's happening with observation. Now the researchers say they want to go to human trials, but what they want to do is they want to take it one step further. Instead of dealing with just the glycerin, they want to see what happens when applying or using the application of phosphatidyl glycerol itself, just to see if they can yield even a greater benefit, especially in the case of psoriasis. Now, may it work with a lot of other skin conditions, for example, individuals with PPE and so on and so forth, because that's pretty much on its own an epidemic on a large scale, because a lot of people are suffering from dry skin, the breakdown of the microbiome of the skin, and other skin disorders. It may, but still, at least we know the mode of action in reference to how it benefits people. Again, gratitude to the researchers. Wonderful, simple, inexpensive, cheap, built upon, I would say, many, many years of traditional use on its own. So they validated the observation as having legitimacy. Again, though, gratitude, thank you. I look forward to see you all once again next week. Links will be there in the study to the full study. And from there, you can take it on your own. Catch you in a bit. Bye. See you next time.